Hey, it's time to talk about music again. Cheap Heat, inexpensive records that rock. What we're listening to right now is a debut record by Jukka Tolonen, guitarist of the Finnish group Tasavallan Presentidi. I think that's how it's pronounced, Presentidi. Anyway, great Finnish band. You should check out their stuff. It's not cheap for the most part. This album was released in the U.S. on Janus Records, as well as throughout Europe on Sonnet or Love Records. And this is the Euro pressing, but it's not super expensive, but the American pressing can be had for less than 10 bucks. And it's just a really fine example of music that's sort of hard to categorize. It's all instrumental. It's definitely got jazzy flourishes and touches on the jazz rock style that was popular at the time. Hard to believe that that style was ever popular. It's my favorite style, but it was, especially in Europe. And Jukka Tolonen is just a fantastic player. Here he's joined by a veritable all-star cast. Most of Tasavallan Presentidi is on here. Pekka Porri on soprano saxophones, and I think he plays alto and flute on here. Pekka Pojola on bass from Wigwam. Reno Lane on drums. I don't think there's a lot of keyboards on this. Maybe a little bit, but not much. It's not a keyboard heavy record. It's a really great sort of guitar, bass, drums, saxophone sort of thing. That was the instrumentation of Tasavallan Presentidi, actually. They also had a vocalist. There's no vocals on this, and it's a great record, so you'll be hearing it in the background while I jabber. I got a lot of guitarists in this lineup of great, cheap albums. The next guy is a guy I've only become aware of recently, like in the last 5 or 7 years or so. It's Toti Soler. There are so many fantastic guitarists coming out of Spain. They've got such a tradition in the flamenco world, and of course all those skills are transferable to rock and to a lesser extent jazz, and a lot of their stuff winds up sounding kind of progressive, which is really cool. And this album, it's from 70, it was recorded in 77, but it came out in 78, and it's mostly acoustic, mostly trios and quartets and duets. There's one or two solo tracks on here, but it's a really just lovely acoustic record. All original compositions, I believe. Lots of flute on this. And it's comparable to some of Luis Panaguia's records. Those are really expensive and have been reissued. This is neither of those things. Sort of flamenco-influenced instrumental music that isn't really flamenco. It's not really rock. It's sort of in between genres. I like this a lot. Soler's first solo record, simply called Toti Soler. He was in a group called Ohm, not the Swiss group Ohm, but the Spanish group Ohm, with a keyboard player named Jordi Sabates. And he, they recorded a duet record, which is also cheap, which I don't have. But this is Soler's first solo record. And it's basically a bass, drums, guitar trio. A lot of it's electric, a lot of it's plugged in, about half of it's acoustic and not plugged in, and very flamenco sounding. But the electric tracks are hard rocking, and this has just been reissued, so you can actually get the OG for about the same price, believe it or not. You might have to pay the postage from Spain, but if you're in Europe, both of these are gonna be really cheap. Anyway, this is a great record too, all instrumental, really adventurous, a lot more tight instrumentally. The playing's better, I think, than on the Ohm record. Just a lot to recommend. It's really good, and if you might see the reissue in your local record store, I would just pick it up. It's highly recommended. Another guitarist who never seemed to get his due, and I just read the Bill Bruford book about playing the drums in Yes and King Crimson. This is the original guitarist in Yes, Peter Banks. And always a favorite of mine, he went and formed the group Flash after Yes, after he left Yes. Steve Howe replaced him, so my gosh, one of the greatest guitarists of all time. But Peter Banks is no slouch, plays keyboards on this as well. This is a strange record. It's sort of an all-star record, because it's got Jan Åkerman and Steve Hackett and John Wetton and Phil Collins on it, as well as the bassist and the drummer from Flash. And the first side is really interesting. Lots of changes and interesting instrumentations and tracks that sort of segue one into the other in interesting ways. I like a lot. The second side is, it says, it's an improvised jam, and that's exactly what it sounds like. It's a sort of a jam record. But, you know, he's jamming with Jan Ackerman, Phil Collins, and Ray Bennett. So it's, oh, yeah, so it's a worthy jam, that's for sure. It's an interesting record. I think people who like progressive rock a lot and maybe psychedelic rock are really going to like this. It's all instrumental. It's kind of a sleeper album. You see it around a lot. If you like the Flash records, you might like this a lot. But it's really cool, and it's sort of a, if you're a Phil Collins fan, you should have this, because he doesn't sing on it, but he does some really great drumming on it. Anyway, it's called Two Sides of Peter Banks, and it's a cool record. A lot of people don't know about it, and it's cheap. It's really cheap, especially the U.S. pressing. Almost all these records have multiple pressings, so you don't have to go for the OG, which might be a little bit more expensive. You can go for the U.S. pressing or whatever. This record only got one pressing, and it was on a private label. The band is called SGO, simply S-G-O, and it comes out of sort of the no-wave period in New York. It's got kind of a sort of punkish ethic to it, but it's definitely a progressive rock type of record. The music on this record was written for plays, and so it goes through a lot of different changes, a lot of different styles, but there's a lot of really cool instrumental stuff on here. Some stuff that sounds like progressive rock, some stuff that sounds like basically instrumental rock and roll, some stuff that has a no wave feel to it. The guys on this record, I hadn't heard of any of them. It's got interesting personnel, just guitar, synth, and drums on one side. They add a bassist on the other side. Some of the players on this record were affiliated with Glenn Branca and that whole downtown New York avant-garde scene. Wharton Tears gets a credit on this. He's also a big name in the downtown avant-garde circles. So it's an interesting record. It's private press and it's super cheap. And it's definitely worth a listen. Or two or three. Check it out. It's called SCO, and the name of the album is Abbreviated. Getting back to more known quantities, the saxophonist from Gong did a solo record called Bloom in 1979, and this is very much like, to me, Gong's best, jazziest stuff. If you like Shamal Eric Gong, you're gonna love this record. There's some vocals on it. They're actually pretty cool. They're sung by a guy named, what's his name? It's escaping me right now. Peter Kimberly, who is in a band called Bach Denkel, that was from Britain but recorded in France. It's kind of a minor all-star lineup here. It comes with a insert. Jan Emmerich on guitars, who later joined Mother Gong. Yano Padovani on drums, amazingly good drummer. Winston Berkeley on bass, mostly known in the Caribbean music circles, but can really play. Miko Nissim on piano and keyboards, fantastic player, more of a jazz guy. And of course, Didier Malherbe on saxophones, and Peter Kimberly on vocals. He plays bass on one track. Very much in the sort of Angel's Egg, Shamal vein. Highly, highly recommended, and superb record. Unfortunately, most of the copies I've seen on Discogs are in Europe, so it'll be really cheap if you're in Europe, less so if you're in the U.S., but be on the lookout for it, because it did get some distribution in the U.S. DDA Malherbe's Bloom. Here's a record that sort of has the opposite thing going for it. It's a small label, U.S. progressive rock / fusion record by a band led by guitarist Mitch Dematoff. It's called Aurora Borealis. self-titled record. I don't know what happened to Mitch Dematoff after he recorded this record, but this is sort of high energy jazz rock fusion, similar to Flight that I've discussed previously. It's got that sort of Midwest hyperactive gee whiz sort of look how many notes we can play, Return to Forever kind of thing going on. I like this record a lot. There is kind of a dud track on it. They do Lady, which is a Lionel Richie tune. And I'm not knocking Lionel Richie, but it's tough to make interesting music, interesting instrumental music out of a pop tune. They give it a go here. And it's not completely awful, but it's certainly not up to the level of the rest of the record, which is easily in the league of Return to Forever. And I mention Return to Forever because the drummer on several of the tracks here later played with Chick Corea. His name's Tom Breckline. He also played with, I believe he played with Robin Ford for a while. Anyway, Tom Breckline's a drummer on this on several tracks, and Bunny Brunel's on bass on a couple of tracks. But the rest of these guys I've never really heard of, but they're all great. They're all really proficient and just killing it all the way through. All kinds of great analog keyboard sounds on this, and just lots of energy. From 1982, so it's still pre-digital, but it's definitely got the 80s sort of production sound to it. I like it a lot, though. It's kind of a sleeper record. Another band I liked in the 80s and 90s, early 90s, when music seemed to be progressive music anyway, fusion, jazz rock, seemed to be kind of tough to track down, was Camper Van Beethoven. And they broke up, and one of the offshoots from Camper Van Beethoven was a band called Monks of Doom. And I really like this record a lot. The second record, they recorded two records. The second one is essentially a Camper Van Beethoven record. This one was ostensibly a soundtrack for a film. It's almost all instrumental. It's not totally instrumental. It's about half and half vocals and instrumentals. And if you like Camper Van Beethoven, you're going to love this. They later formed the band Cracker, and some of the members of this band had considerable commercial success. This is a really great record. It's from the late 80s, I believe, 1987. It came out on the Pitch a Tent label. And yeah, it's just a remarkably good record. And I don't know what else to say about it. It just blew me away. I listened to it a lot back then. There wasn't much going on in terms of rock. You had arena rock, and you had new wave, which I didn't like, and punk, which I kind of liked, actually. And that's when I really started listening to free jazz and all the Soul Note Black Saint stuff. It was in the 80s. There just wasn't a whole lot else going on in music. And also, the whole harmonic thing was big then. But this is a good example of a late 80s progressive rock record that really cooks and highly worth checking out. The title of the record's rather long. Soundtrack to the film Breakfast on the Beach of Deception by the Monks of Doom. Get that one. This album isn't so cheap anymore and might already be disqualified. But Colosseum was a great 60s band with horns, led by drummer John Heisman. He got it back together in a different format in the late 70s, early 80s. Called it Colosseum 2. Basically, it was a power quartet with Don Airey on keys and Neil Murray on bass, later John Mull, and Gary Moore on guitar. That was the real attraction. Gary Moore was an amazing, amazing guitar player. This was their first album. It was done with a vocalist who's actually quite good. But this is a beautiful record. It's fantastic. Far better than oddly, far better. I like it much more than the instrumental ones they recorded later on. But yeah, if you ever see this, grab it. It only came out in Europe, never came out in the US, unlike their later stuff. But yeah, it's this tremendously inspired progressive rock. I don't know what else to say about it. And the players are unimpeachable. They all played with great bands before and after making this record. Neil Murray was in National Health. I think he later joined Whitesnake, oddly enough. Don Airey also was in an Ian Gillan band, I think. I might be wrong about that. But anyway, great record. Strange New Flesh is the title. I'm going to wrap up with a couple of all-time favorite bands of mine whose albums are still pretty cheap. One being Camel. This is their debut. fantastic record. I got it recently and it just blew me away how good it was. I've been into them forever. And it could be had pretty cheap and it's pressed multiple times. Moon Madness is another great record to get by them. They almost get into sort of a Soft Machine sort of sound on this. Love this record. Rain Dances, much more vocal oriented, but still fantastic. But the real gem is the live record. They did a two record live album. And if you like the album they did called The Snow Goose, they do the entire thing on this at record live. And very worthwhile. I don't have The Snow Goose right now. That's a really good record too. But this is fantastic. If you have never checked Camel out and you like progressive rock or adventurous music in general, definitely check out their 70s records and into the early 80s maybe. Nude was the last one I got. I don't have it anymore. That was pretty good. Finally, I always liked krautrock. And when people think of krautrock, they think of a certain specific thing, lots of synthesizers, sort of machine-like vocals. But there's a lot more going on in Germany than just that. They love jazz rock. They loved fusion. They love jazz over there. And this band, Kron, sort of tried to do it all. And they're kind of lumped in with krautrock. They're not sort of your typical krautrock. They definitely have the sort of passport jazz funk thing happening. A lot of their stuff's instrumental. But the vocal tracks are more like sophisticated pop-inflected jazz. Kind of like Steely Dan, oddly enough, I think. That's my personal bias there. But this one is called Let It Out. It came out in the U.S. on Passport. They had another one, Andy Nager, that came out in the U.S. on Passport and is also cheap. I don't have that one anymore. I think it's almost all vocal. This is, I prefer this one because it's more than half instrumental. And they had been a quartet, saxophone, guitar, bass, and drums. And the saxophonist had so many appliances on his saxophone that it sounded like a mini Moog almost. They added a keyboard on this one. It's the guy from a band called Cartago. What was his name? Ingo Bischoff. And he really adds a lot to the sound of the band. And I highly recommend this record. I just listened to it to just make sure I still liked it. And it is excellent. Finally, they did a two-record live set that came out in many versions. It was released in England on the Gull label. That version is really cheap. This is a later edition of it's like a repress from the 70s of the original German issue on Intercord Records with the, there's a mark of quality, the fried egg. I always like that logo. Anyway, this is great. They do all the material from most of their early stuff. They started off life in a commune and did sort of jammy, jazzy, crowdy, progressive rock. And then their second album was almost like sort of like a singer-songwriter sounding thing. I didn't like it so much. But later on, they sort of went back to the jazz and funk and fusion of their very first record. And this is their most jazzy stuff. So if you ever see Kron live, the issue on Gull has a different cover. Get it. It's quite good. Anyway, tracks are long too. Nice long tracks. And they can really play. Anyway, that's Cheap Heat. Hope you liked it. And I'll be back with more real soon.